Hey everyone, it's Chaz. Welcome back to the channel. In this video, we will be looking at LeetCode problem 1464, maximum product of two elements. I promise there's actually a T back there. There you go. Maximum product of two elements. All right, so let's take a look at the problem statement. It says, given the array of integers called nums, you will choose two different indices, index I and index j of that array, and return the maximum value of nums at I minus one times nums of j minus one. So this is best explained with an example. Take example one here. I have an array containing 3, 4, 5, and 2. In order to get a maximum product, we're going to need the two largest values in this array, which are the 4 and the 5. And they don't want you to just multiply 4 times 5. They want you to subtract 1 from each of those numbers. So you're not multiplying 4 times 5, you're multiplying 3 times 4, which is 12, and so you return 12. Looking at example 2, this time my array contains 1, 5, 4, and 5. There are 2 5s in the array, and they both represent the two largest values in the array, so choose both 5s, but don't multiply 5 times 5. Instead, subtract 1 and multiply 4 times 4, which will be 16, and so we return 16. And then finally here, example 3, we have an array that only contains 2 values, 3 and 7, so we must choose the 3 and the 7. We subtract 1 from each of them before multiplying. So instead of 3 times 7, we should do 2 times 6. And so we return 12. Now looking at this array here in example 3, I now have some questions about the values that we will receive in this array nums. If I received this question in an interview, and especially if I saw this example, the very next question I'm going to have is, what should I do if the array contains fewer than 2 values, because then I can't choose the top 2. Another question that I might immediately have for my interviewer is, what is the largest and the smallest possible values that I can receive in this array? And that's because, you know, if I'm subtracting 1 from these values, what if I think I'm choosing the 2 largest values in the array, but then as it turns out, there are negative numbers in my array, which you multiply 2 negative numbers, you get a positive. These are usually things that the interviewers will intentionally leave out because they're expecting you to ask about them. They just want to see if you can think about these edge cases. Fortunately, on LeetCode, they answer these questions for us by providing constraints. And our constraints actually address all of these concerns that I just had. For example, nums.length, or the number of values that will be in my array, has a minimum of 2. So there will be at least 2 values in the array. It's guaranteed, so I don't have to worry about what to do if there's only 1 value in the array or if the array is empty. And then as for that other concern about the values themselves, I do see that there could be a 1 in my array, but there won't be any negatives. So I don't have to worry about a situation where 2 of the values are negative and they multiply into a positive. And then on the other side, the largest possible value in my array is going to be 1,000. And that's also great for us because if that number appears twice in the array, 1,000 times 1,000 is only 1 million. And 1 million can fit into a 32-bit integer. So that means, like for example, in Java, if I'm using an int to hold my maximum product, I don't have to worry about the integer overflowing. I know that 1,000 times 1,000 is 1 million, and an int variable in Java can store the number 1 million with no problem. Now, there are multiple ways to solve this problem. And somebody in an interview mindset who's been really studying on their data structures and their algorithms, the first thing that that type of person might do is consider sorting the array. Sort the array using arrays.sort in Java, and then just find the 2 largest values. But let's look at the time complexity of solving the problem this way. Sorting the array in general, anytime you're going to use a sort, you should expect the time complexity to be n times log of n. And then once I have sorted the array, finding the 2 largest values can be done in constant time. They go of 1 because they're just the values on the end of the array. Someone who's really been studying their data structures might also suggest to add all the values to a priority queue and then pull the top 2 values. Let's look at the time complexity of that. When you're adding values to a priority queue, basically it's setting up a tree structure for these values, so they effectively are being sorted. So the time complexity of adding all the values to the priority queue will also be big O of n times log of n. Now you might be inclined to think that pulling the top 2 values from a priority queue would just be done in constant time, but believe it or not, it's actually log of n. So if you're not familiar with a priority queue or a heap structure, what happens is when you input values into a priority queue, in our case, integers, they will be arranged in order of priority, which for integers by default, they would be arranged in increasing order so that the value with the biggest priority would be the smallest number. So that would be known as a min heap. In our case, we might actually want to reverse that so that the largest priority goes to the largest value, and that would be a max heap. Now, behind the scenes in a priority queue, it's actually keeping track of the largest values or the highest priority values with a binary tree structure. You could think of it, say, as like a pyramid of balls where the value on top is always larger than the values of the two balls immediately below it, or it always has higher priority. When I remove the top ball from this pyramid, I need to somehow retain the pyramid structure. So there needs to be a shift in the way the balls are arranged so that I can still have a top one at the top of the pyramid. And by the way, just as an aside, if you ever have to search Google for pyramid of balls, please turn on safe search first. I had to learn that lesson the hard way. No pun intended. So the reason why I like this problem so much is because it's really good for beginners, and it's also really good for intermediate learners, because if you've been studying your data structures and your algorithms, you might come up with one of these two solutions. But if you're a complete beginner just learning Java, you will come up with a completely different solution, and that solution is actually the most efficient solution. So let me show you the linear scan strategy. Suppose we have an array of these numbers here. What we're going to do is create two variables, max1 and max2. They're going to represent the value that is in first place, so the largest value in the array, and the second largest value in the array. We're going to traverse this array starting at index 0, so starting with the first value in the array, which is a 3. So starting with the 3, we just need to ask, is 3 greater than max1? Or in other words, is 3 the largest value we have encountered so far? And if it is, then we're going to copy max1's value over to max2, and then copy this 3 into max1. So it may not be obvious why I had to do that first step just yet, but you'll see in just a moment. But for now, we're going to copy 0 from max1 over to max2, so nothing happens. And then we copy this 3 into max1. So now let's just move over to the next value in the array. That's a 5. And then we ask the same question. Is 5 greater than 3? Greater than max1? And it is. So now you might see why we have to kind of slide the 3 over into the max2 slot. So slide that 3 into max2, and then we can copy the 5 into max1. Basically, since we need to keep track of the first place and second place values, every time we get a new first place value, we have to remember what the old one was, because the old one should now be the second place value. Now we move to the next value in the array, and it is not greater than max1, but if you notice, it is greater than max2. So this really should be the second place value. So we need to account for this new situation. If the number at index I is greater than max2, then do nothing to max1, but we do have to change max2. And so we'll copy the value at index I into max2. So copy this 4 into the variable max2. And then all we have to do is take these steps and apply them to every value in the array. So moving on to the next value, which is a 7. 7 is greater than max1. So this should be our new first place value, but we have to remember this 5 because the 5 should now be in second place. So copy the 5 into max2 and then take our 7 and copy it into max1. And then finally, we get to the last value in the array. It's not bigger than max1, and it's not bigger than max2, so we should just do nothing in this case. At this point, we reach the end of the array. Our two largest values are the 7 and the 5. We don't multiply 7 times 5. Instead, we multiply 6 times 4, and so we return 24. This algorithm is faster than the other two that we mentioned where we sort an array or use a priority queue. The time complexity of this is only big O of n, where n is the number of elements in the array. And that's because we only have to check each element once. There's no sorting, so we don't introduce that extra complexity. And then the space complexity here is big O of 1, or constant space, because all we did was store two integers, max1 and max2, and no other memory was needed. Unlike, say, the priority queue, where we had to use the same amount of memory that was required for the array in extra space in order to create that tree structure for the priority queue. So for me, the main takeaway of a problem like this is just when you're in an interview, you don't need to always overthink it. Sometimes the simplest solution turns out to be the best solution. So anyway, we've now seen our algorithm, so there's only one thing left to do. Let's code some Java. All right, so the first thing that I said I would do was create two int variables, max1 and max2. I said that I initialized them to 0 because I know that the smallest value in the array will be a 1, and I just wanted to pick values to initialize that were going to be smaller than every value in the input array. And then I said we would traverse through all of the elements of the array. So I have that here in a for loop. And I'm actually using an enhanced for loop here. So for each int that I'm calling x in the array nums, if x is greater than max 1, then I need to remember to shift the current max 1 value into max 2. So that's this line here, max 2 equals max 1. And then I can take this x and put it into max 1. So max 1 equals x. And then I said I had to also account for the situation where my current number in the array is not greater than max 1, but it is greater than max 2. So I'm using an else if for that. In the case where x is greater than max 2, then I will simply take my x and copy it into max 2. So max 2 equals x. And then once I am done going through each number in the array, I will be left with max 1 as the largest value from the array and max 2 as the second largest value. And so we're going to multiply those together, but we have to subtract 1 from each one first. So that's what I do here on line 16. Take max 1, subtract 1, take max 2 and subtract 1, and then multiply those quantities together. And that will be my final answer. All right, so that's it for this video. Hope you were able to solve this problem. Let me know in the comments if you were. Please subscribe to the channel if you want to see more LeetCode, and that's it. I'll see you next time.